Tom Gunning, an early 20th century film theorist, coins the phrase cinema of attraction to describe the majority of films made before 1906. These films were produced before the Hollywood studio system and lacked narrative, for plot was not often central in cinema at the time. Topics tended to be exhibitionist in nature by featuring acts of display, such as boxing or kissing, as pictures coming to life. These films manifested themselves through presentation and produced a sense of immediacy and presence, which made them highly effective in engaging the senses. The audience was further engaged or attracted by the novelty of cinematic manipulation, such as stop-motion editing, which was commonly used in trick films.
In the 1902 A Trip to the Moon, Georges Méliès evokes the idea of a world filled with fantastical scenes using design sets made with fabricated grayscale backdrops and two-dimensional paintings as props. Although primitive to us, these special effects attracted the audience because they were new and exciting to see and experience on the screen. Even the characters are presented as spectacles, as their actions appear to be overacted, animated motions. Through Méliès' trick effects, such as double exposure and superimposition, the audience travels towards the moon. These special effects not only animate the moon with a face, but use superimposition cuts and painted props to fabricate a rocket ship crashing into the moon's eye, a mysterious and magical spectacle for the audience to visually experience at the time. The role of the narrative in Méliès' films is very different than later traditional narrative films, as plot and story are used to create excuses for stage effects here.
After 1906, Gunning argues that while cinema pushed away from the immediacy of the spectacular image and towards the structure of linear narrative, cinema of attractions did not cease to exist, but was simply absorbed into this new narrative cinema. This fight scene between King Kong and a Tyrannosaurus Rex took over 7 weeks to film, as it not only required stop motion editing, but also used the groundbreaking optical printer to combine the foreground, the stop motion animation, the live action footage, and the background all into one single shot. Although the audience went to watch the story, as narrative was central to the cinema at this point, they were captivated by the magic that brought a fantastic prehistoric world of giant snakes, pterodactyls, and King Kong into the same realm as famous actors and actresses.
Time is notoriously unkind to the cinema of attractions. What to one generation is unprecedented and spectacular seems to the next an artifact of primitive times. Today, cinema of attraction is typically found hidden within films through the use of the most advanced forms of technology. With this shamelessly unoriginal plot and shoddy acting, James Cameron's 2009 Avatar acts as an excuse to exhibit advanced CGI animation and 3D technologies. Its $2.7 billion box office sales were largely due to the CGI's creation of a lifelike fantastical world to amaze and attract the audience. Like Gunning argues, plot and story here, and in most modern films, are only used as an excuse to showcase these special effects.
Wes Anderson, however, is doing quite the opposite. Rather than using state-of-the-art technology, Wes Anderson's films such as The Grand Budapest Hotel and Fantastic Mr. Fox use what society would be considered outdated technologies reminiscent of Tom Gunning's cinema of attraction style animation. The attraction within most modern films is their high-tech special effects. For Wes Anderson, however, it's the nostalgia he creates. One way Wes Anderson pays homage to this nostalgia is his use of miniature sets and multi-sized models of the actors, which are used to shoot high-action scenes like the ski chase, through stop-motion editing instead of computer animation and stunt doubles, as Wes Anderson explains here.
And Willem is somebody who is a very physical actor, and he can do more or less anything, but skiing is not in his wheelhouse. So his skiing is done by a puppet that's about that tall, really. Kind of a monochromatic puppet. It's quite complicated how we did it, but it's pretty rudimentary. There's not a lot of state-of-the-art technology that went into it. But there are a lot of miniature sets and sort of a very lively atmosphere with a group of animators and model builders and things.
When it comes to visual stimulation, the Hollywood blockbuster is doomed to forever try to top itself. The threshold for suspending our disbelief only goes up. The audience is always yearning for something new, something different, something amazingly more advanced from the last blockbuster hit that tops the most recent state-of-the-art special effects. Wes Anderson does not play this game of cat and mouse. Instead of attracting his audience with distinctly new animation technology and special effects, he uses the seemingly outdated stop-motion animation, which is new and distinct from modern films in its own right.
In Fantastic Mr. Fox, the complicated dual nature of the main characters, who are both characteristically human as they wear clothes and have human concerns, and animal at the same time, is enhanced through Anderson's use of stop motion. The technique reinforces this duality by its portrayal of the characters who seem to exist somewhere between the real and the fantastic. Unlike CGI, which aims for flawless realism, stop motion embraces the imperfection, the glitches, making it, in a way, more tangible and lifelike. Not only do the vividly realistic stop-motion details of the sets and characters attract the audience, but the overly animated motions and expressions of the characters also act to create spectacle similar to Gunning's cinema of attractions.
He doesn't seem to know.
I have a phobia of wolves.
What a beautiful creature. Wish him luck, boys.
Luck to you.
Good luck, boys.
Good luck out there.
Finally, as Wes Anderson explains it himself,
Jeremy Dawson, our producer, he knows every detail of how we did this, but is there anything you'd throw in there?
Just the fact that we literally had the camera on skateboard wheels, like, upside down, pushing it with a stick.
Camera on skateboard wheels, upside down, pushing it with a stick. Does that more or less lay it out for you? I think we can
leave
it at that.
That clears that up.